Welcome to View from the Top. I am Modede Sharafa Yusuf. In contemporary times, the achievements of Nigerian women have risen. This began from the Second Republic when there began to be better prospects for women. At that time, a few Nigerian women won elections into the House of Representatives, even though there were only two women appointed federal ministers. Around that time also, in 1980, the women ratio in the federal civil service was about 12.6%, up from about 9% that it was in 1970. Much earlier, around 1963, less than 7% of the salaried workforce were women. But it was about this time that Mrs. Toyin Olakunri became Africa's first female chartered accountant. One of Nigeria's celebrated professional women, Mrs. Olakunri, joins me on View from the Top today, and I feel truly honored. Thank you very much, Mrs. Olakunri, for joining us.
Thank you very much for inviting me.
And I thank you for tuning in. Here's a quick biography of my guest before our conversation. Born on November 4, 1937, Mrs. Toyin Olakunri attended Houghton School, Essex, Bournemouth College of Technical Education, and University of Birmingham, England. She qualified as a Chartered Accountant of England and Wales in 1963. She has been an auditor, bank executive, stockbroker, industrialist, and consultant. Mrs. Olakunri is the former president of the Society of Women Accountants in Nigeria, former president, Institute of Chartered Accountants of Nigeria, former president of Institute of Directors, council member of Ondo State University at Ado Ekiti, member of Vision 2010 committee, former board member of Nigeria LNG Limited. She was also chairman of Footwear and Accessories Manufacturing and Distribution. Mrs. Olakunri was a pioneer and two-term chairman of the Educational Trust Fund from 1999 to 2007. She has received the ICANN Merit Award, and she's an officer of the Federal Republic. Mr. Olakunri, tell us, what were the major achievements of the Education Trust Fund when you were chairman?
The Education Trust Fund had been established some years earlier, and a few of us were asked to be on the board. That was something like 8 years or so before it actually manifested. And its purpose was to collect taxes from corporate bodies, a percentage of their profits, and to use it for improving education through funding. We were not involved in anything else but to provide funds for educational institutions to improve themselves. The reason I go to that extent is that right now they've changed it to TET Fund, okay. At that time, I think 25% of the money went to primary level, 25% to secondary, and 50% to tertiary. There was a body before us, but it was only for a few months. But we were the first body to really start implementing what was in the decree. The taxes were being collected, slowly were being collected. When there was no body there, Inland Revenue boys were not particularly keen about collection. Because when we arrived, they said, look, this tax is supposed to collect for you. We don't get any facilities for it from government. We want you now to provide, print the papers we used to even collect it. Because otherwise, it's the facility they give us for others that we're using. So, and so on and so forth. So we really had to step in and get it functioning. So it started function. And I'm proud to say that we were able to reach every one of the 774 local governments in the country. We really tried very hard to reach them. In the case of the primary and secondary, we were able to identify what their biggest needs were and try to provide funding for them to put those in place. In the case of the tertiary, everybody knew what their needs were. And there was a year particularly when there was no provision for any capital expenditure in any state university in Nigeria, and we were the only ones able to give them funds for anything they had to do in that area. We made quite an impact. Everywhere we go, there was an occasion once when the president invited a few of us to talk about some funding in the country. And I remember the head of the National Revenue Mobilization then said, Everywhere I go, I see ETF. That's not what you're there for. I said, yes, that's what we're there for. We're there to make sure that everybody in Nigeria feels an impact. And I think everybody did.
You know, research institutes recently staged a protest to the National Assembly demanding inclusion of all research institutes and colleges of agriculture as TED Fund beneficiaries. As you said, ETF is now TED Fund.
Yes.
Chief Afe Babalola also once called for an amendment of Section 7(1) of the TED Fund Act in order to address what he called the unconstitutional, unfair and unjustifiable exclusion of private institutions from benefiting from the funds accruable from the Tertiary Education Trust Fund. Should all these institutions and private universities benefit from that fund?
I feel very strongly so. The reason being that essentially the money is from the private sector. And the idea was that for us to make sure that those who come out to work with them are well educated, are better educated. And so naturally, it should benefit everybody, both those in the private sector and in the ones that are funded by government. I very much support the idea. Even Obasanjo government, Jonathan's government, they really feel no. They feel that you make enough money as a private investor in education, but they don't really make that much because people in Nigeria don't have that much funds to make available. I'm very much in favor of it. It should be done. They should have the opportunity. If the money comes from the private sector, and private sector should benefit from it.
Education continues to be challenged by lack of funds. What do we do now when things are so dire that a state government is beginning to sell off public schools? Should we consider increasing the 2% education tax imposed on the accessible profit of all registered companies in Nigeria, or what?
I think that the Ministry of Education, generally, both at state level and at federal level, need more funding. But I don't think it's necessarily from the TED Fund education tax. I don't think it is. That is there for a particular purpose, and I think it meets that purpose. It is actually there because the other sectors, which really are for education, fail. So I think it's more important for us to get more funding from government for the education sector, rather than to tax all companies to make more money available. It'll just make the state provide even less funding for education.
Apart from funding, what do you reckon are the problems of education?
Lack of motivation. Teachers are not motivated. Nobody's encouraged to go in for education, to teach. Nobody's teaching. Nobody wants to teach. If you come across someone who's done a degree in education or whatever it is, or teacher training, they'll tell you, I'm just managing teaching until I find something better. Nobody wants to teach. Maybe it's said that their reward is in heaven. Yes, it is. However, I think that they should get some of it whilst they're here on earth. But because they don't get it, they're not committed. They're not committed at all. And they haven't been properly taught either, because this lack of care for the teachers have been on for 3 or 4 generations now. And so, rarely, education should be very poor. It is, I'm sure it is. I compare what I benefited at school, like primary school and early secondary school, with what's available now. And I know that we really have to seriously consider our education system.
What did you learn from your time in public service? What did you learn about how things work in Nigeria?
I think that people are not loyal to the nation. I know when we first got there, one of the first things we did was to try to find ways of generating income, additional income, for this purpose. And everybody kept saying, no, government doesn't want any more money. They have more than enough money. No, just use it anyhow. And that was the feeling, not only within, ETF, but within the ministry. There was a no caring attitude. And civil servants are not encouraged to care. They're not encouraged to put themselves out for the salary they get, for the country, for the salary they get. They're not. They're just there. They just see it as their luck. They're not committed. And unfortunately, people who come in as ministers are also not committed. They come in because they've been appointed, because They have a big say in the political party, and they're not, they don't have a plan, they don't have a program, they don't have a vision for education. They don't. They just, I remember an incident, soon after we got there, we said, one of the things we must do is encourage information technology. And so we set up a conference, a seminar. We got people to come from Canada. We got the Minister for Science and Technology to come and agree to come and open it. Of course, we had informed our ministry, education, before we did all of this. And then about a week to the time, I then went to the ministry to say, let me have the minister's speech. Minister's speech? What are you talking about? You didn't get our approval before you did that. How do you know that we want to put efforts into IT? No, we're cancelling it. And they cancelled it. We brought it up again about 6 months later, but they cancelled it. We had to write to everybody all over the world to say, please don't come. It's not functioning. They're just not caring. And I think also that could be improved if career civil servants are put in their ministry, in their area of competence, and grow within that. But you are in education today, you are in aviation tomorrow, you are in whatever else it is, and you go to each one fresh, not knowing anything. And before you're able to even learn about it, you're moved again to something else. I think maybe there should be permanent secretaries are permanent. And I think there should be staff within the ministry who are permanently within that discipline and not moved
but
around.
But even permanent secretaries are not permanent.
They're not.
They're moved around.
They're not. They move them around. They should be permanent. That's what I'm saying.
We have to take a break now. Please join us again.